Hello and welcome to this workshop slash presentation, which is entitled The History of the British Folk Guitar Accompanying the Songs, and it's for the Sidmouth Folk Festival Online 2020. And in this instance, I am your host, Jack Rutter, and it's great to meet you, and I hope you're well and good. Before we begin with this workshop, all about the history of the British folk guitar, I'm going to put a few disclaimers on it, if you don't mind. The first one being that the history of the British folk guitar is, you know, that's a pretty sizable thing. That's pretty huge. So because of that, and because this workshop is under an hour, there are quite a few people, unfortunately, who I've had to miss out because I didn't have space to put them in. So apologies to those incredible guitarists, musicians and influential people over the past 70 years or so who I haven't been able to get into this workshop. And my second disclaimer on this workshop is that this is just my perspective and thoughts on things. I'm in no way the authority on this matter. Like I say, it's a huge subject. You could do massive PhDs and big books all about it. I'm in no way the person to be doing that in an academic way, shape or form type of thing. These are just the thoughts of an excited enthusiast and what I think about things. And hopefully it can be educational, entertaining and informing for you, whether you are, you know, an advanced guitarist who already knows a lot about what I'm going to tell you about now, or if you're a person who's never even touched a guitar, doesn't know how many strings one might have, or even what you might do with those strings were you to have one. Hopefully, you know, you can all get something out of this. So without further ado, let's proceed, let's begin. The history of the British folk guitar. In we pop. Introduction. Why accompany? Why would we use a guitar within the context of traditional songs? It could be argued, and has been argued by a few people in the past, that there's no place for accompanying songs with guitars, and that unaccompanied is the only or best way for doing things and is the most effective way at delivering narratives and stories and intent and music, you know, traditional songs wise. And, you know, in some cases that might be true. Some of the finest music in the world is unaccompanied singing, but then also some of the finest music in the world, again, this is all my opinion, but is also traditional singing with guitars and other instruments that are going to accompany them. So, as this point that popped up just there says, sometimes this is true, maybe. Sometimes it's not, though. Also, maybe. I've got a really good example, which we're now going to listen to, which can hopefully prove the second point there. And this example is one of the greatest pieces of music ever recorded, and usefully for me in this context now, it's also a great example of why accompaniment can really, especially from a guitar, can really help and bring out all the elements of a traditional song and the narrative and the intent and all that. But it can also create like a whole sonic universe, which is then in your head, which then the singing can sit in the middle of. And so it paints all these huge, brilliant pictures, which then can help deliver the story in a kind of a cinematic way. So this example is one of the most famous pieces of music, English folk-wise. This is Nick Jones's version of Canady I.O., which we'll listen to. And one of the main reasons why I think this is such a good example for this is, whilst the singing is obviously just glorious because it's Nick Jones and the man's a genius, in this instance, I think that, you know, without the guitar accompaniment under this particular song and the way he's singing it, it would be in no way as strong. If it was just an unaccompanied song he was singing, you know, just the melody line of this one, I think it would have nowhere near as much impact, obviously. So it's a good example of when, instrumental accompaniment can really bolster stuff. So we'll have a little listen to it now. So peel your ears.
Sailor boy, and it's true that she loved him well. For to go off to sea with him, like she did not know how. She longed to see that seaport town called Kennedy Isle.
Well, wasn't that just glorious? It physically pained me to have to edit there, make the cut there at that point in the song and not include it all. However, there's only so much time in this workshop. However, that also gives you an excuse to, if for whatever reason you've never heard that album, Penguin Eggs, then, or I never heard that song, then I envy you greatly because you just got to hear it for the first time in your life. And that's, yeah, like I said, I'm very jealous of that. So what you should do is you should head over to the Topic Records website and buy yourself a copy of Penguin Eggs. And similarly, all of the other musicians and songs and albums I mention in this workshop, I strongly suggest that you should go and get their CDs because that's a great thing to do and you will not be disappointed. So let's carry on. What we're going to do in this workshop is we're going to look at instruments, players, techniques and ideas associated with the British folk guitar, and then we're going to listen to and watch some specific examples. And hopefully doing this will then inform our decision making when approaching a traditional song to accompany. So we'll now look at the first approaches to British folk guitar. So the steel string acoustic guitar, this here is a steel string acoustic guitar. It's got steel strings, you see. Classical guitars, they have nylon strings, so it's a different sound. But the steel string acoustic guitar was kind of it was an American invention mostly. So the first thing there was, at least traditional song-wise, was more American trad guitar accompaniment from people like the Carter family. And then going back to my earlier disclaimer, there's probably earlier examples, but the first British approach that I can think of is Davy Graham, who invented the tuning dadgad. We're going to go more into tunings later, so don't worry if you don't understand what that means. I'll explain later. And he did that with Shirley Collins singing in 1964. And to me, and that's on the album Folk Roots, New Roots, and to me, it's a quite American-informed style of guitar playing, but it's obviously so interesting when those things merge and come together. So we'll listen to that first kind of British folk guitar chronological approach now. So again, listen up.
Town. soul would look up, not a soul would look down, not a soul would look up, not a soul would look down, to show me the way to Van Ottoman town. I rode a big horse that...
So yeah, that was an example of, yeah, the first, at least to my mind, British folk guitar song accompaniment. And from then on came the development of the British folk guitar accompaniment, you know, right up until the present day, from 1964 onwards. It's tricky to organise and to categorise so many different amazing players, but a useful way of doing it could be by splitting their, well, predominantly right hands, unless they're left-handed. So actually, the hand that they're using that's closest to the bridge of the guitar. So the hand that's closest, so that hand, we can split that hand into three categories or subcategories. So we've got finger style, which means that you are playing the guitar with your fingers rather than with a plectrum or a pick. So like this. Some players use a thumb pick, but that's still, I don't know, I'm going to still categorise that as finger style, so because you're going. Playing with a flat pick, or a plectrum, or a pick, whichever you want to call it. So that's. Playing hybrid, which is where you're playing with a plectrum, but you're also playing with your fingers as well, so it's kind of. See, I'm playing my fingers there. And we can look at some of these players now. So, finger style wise, there's the granddaddy of it all. Martin Carthy, who plays with a metal thumb pick, actually, to give himself a bit of a heavier attack there on the lower strings. And we'll be talking about and listening to more Martin Carthy later on. And there's Nick Jones, playing with a thumb pick, often played with a thumb pick. There's Chris Wood, who also plays with a thumb pick and plays a lot of fingerstyle guitar. There's the incredible Corinne Polwart, who when she's playing fingerstyle, as far as I'm aware, doesn't use a thumb pick, and that's more so she's using the flesh of her thumb to pick the strings. And there's the incredible Martin Simpson, who plays with a thumb pick and also with amazing nails. He's got longer nails that are reinforced, that create an incredibly beautiful sound. And then flat picking wise, there's John Doyle. So obviously, yeah, it's the British folk guitar and the huge Irish influence on all of that. He has such a rhythmic, percussive kind of style. Not percussive as in hitting the guitar, but percussive as just in, it sounds like a drum kit when he's playing, which is amazing. There's Chris Drever, who plays in Lao and on his own and with lots of people. And recently, actually, I've seen him doing a lot more kind of finger style and hybrid picking type stuff, just because he can, because he's that good. There's the amazing Jen Butterworth, who, to say similarly to John Doyle, would be a disservice to both of them, but also has, you know, a hugely percussive, big drum kit kind of sound. Well worth listening out for. She plays in Canaris Quintet and accompanies Ryan Young, as well as a host of amazing other traditional musicians. That's Ian Carr. He plays with a flat pick. plays with the plectrum and has been around for many years, making amazing music in a variety of different configurations, as well as on his own. And there's the brilliant Denny Bartley, who is amazing at a kind of driving dadgad style. To say simple would be, again, doing a disservice to it, but elegantly, brilliantly simple and direct and forthright and just doing it and not taking any prisoners. And he does that a lot for songs as well. It is accompaniment for traditional songs. And then hybrid, people who are doing both. There's Richard Thompson, and he's playing with a pick and with his fingers. So in that kind of... And then there's the brilliant Jim Morey, who plays with both a lot as well. And there's Dick Gocken, also does a lot of hybrid stuff, as well as doing... But it kind of goes without saying that all of these amazing players can do an amount of all three things, really, generally. Tunings. This is going to be fun. So when we're looking at tunings on instruments over the years, so... 15th century cisterns, and you know, going back hundreds of years, cisterns which are very different from modern day cisterns, but like in a way they're kind of precursors to guitars. They were in all sorts of tunings, and they had capos all over the shop, including like single string capos. This is a capo here, if you don't know. What it does is it kind of shortens the neck artificially, so it means that it becomes, the pitch becomes higher. So here it is with the capo on, higher, take the capo off, lower. But you can get capos on individual strings, which is then can change individual notes, which is what lots of cisterns were doing. So they were using open tunings, were our kind of medieval forebears, if that's the right word. At some point, this got kind of standardised to regular tuning, or EADGBE, which is used often for, and mostly for West, which was implemented generally for Western classical music, which then, and then it became popular with the development of popular music, etc., and in all its forms. And you could argue that it's because it's most versatile. So that's EADGBE, but I've got a capo on. You can play in lots of keys in that standard tuning, and they're all quite strong, whereas in some open tunings some keys aren't quite as strong as other ones. It's a very simple way of looking at it. And with more world music coming to the fore, at least in kind of British folk guitar circles in the 60s, Davy Graham invented dadgad, which is completely modal in that. So by that we mean I think of a way of describing it without going too heavy. Modal in that it doesn't... Oh, it didn't have a third in it, so it's not really in a Western key in that way, in a standard Western key, in that a major third, there's a third note in the scale, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So that's the major third, quite happy sounding. It's in that key for now. Minor third, quite sad sounding, it's in that key for now. So, you know, things like open D tuning, which we use a lot and still I use a lot, they're more in. That's, you kind of set in that key a little bit. Same for that, if that was the tuning. Whereas dadgad, that G, which is one up from the major third, it leaves it quite open. Leaves it quite versatile for playing in lots of different keys because it's not centred around one key. And common tunings in British folk guitar today. The standard, like we were saying, EADGBE. Sometimes, more for American players or American kind of traditional music, but you know, that's a, it's quite a general sweeping statement to make there of me. There, drop D, where I'm just going to take this off, put this cap off. Drop D would sound like this, and what's happened is that E standard has been dropped. So, you've got that low D to play with at the bottom, chunky bottom D. Double drop D, used a lot by some great Irish players. D-A-D-G-B-D. Can't remember if I just said that or not, but I said it again. So you've got a D at the top and a D at the bottom. Dadgad, which is what this is in now. C-G-C-G-C-D. Chris Wood uses this tuning a lot. It's got a hanging ninth in it, so I'll try and explain that. So the tuning itself would sound something... I can't put this guitar in that tuning because the strings won't take it. However, it would sound... It's like this. And that hanging ninth, which is that note there, because it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. To me, that's quite a plaintive sound. It's quite... Because it either wants to go up to... Or it wants to go down. So, and go back home again. So, there's a melancholy-ness about it, which is probably somehow rooted in our DNA about it. It sounds like it's like a bird that either wants to go away or wants to go back home. It's a bit of a weird way of looking at it, but yeah. So Chris Wood plays in that tuning a lot. He plays in loads of keys in it, though. He doesn't restrict himself to just playing in C. I read an interview with him once where he said he'd got sick of retuning half the time in gigs and then being out of tune the other half the time because he was retuning so much. So he thought he'd stick with that one and make it work for him, which obviously he has done phenomenally well. CGD, GCD, which should be like this. And that comes out of old banjo tunings. I think Jim Murray uses that tuning a lot, but again, I could be wrong. And then there's Martin Carthy tuning, which is CGC, DGA, which I actually don't think I'm able to recreate on this guitar right now. That's pretty out there tuning wise. I've never come across anybody ever who is giving this a serious go, apart from Martin Carthy himself. He came upon this tuning by trying to make the noise that was in his head come out of the guitar. So he came upon this tuning after wiggling around with lots of different other configurations for a while, which is just really cool, isn't it? And the thing, that's what he's, one quote of his is, the thing about the really great traditional musicians is that they're all totally unique. Which is a quote that can be very directly applied to him, especially with using that amazing, strange tuning. So next up, what are we on? Guitar types. Great fun. Brilliant. Right. So, again, there's so many makers and builders of instruments over the years. But loosely, we'll look at a couple of people, and unfortunately I have to miss out loads of others, but we'll look at classic American guitars and then also kind of British slash Celtic designs. Starting with American designs, there's Martin Carthy with his, I think his own signature triple O. I think it's a triple O. Again, I could be wrong. Answers on a postcard if you think I'm wrong. Sorry. And he is with... one of the Mr. Martins there from Martin Guitars. Martin Carthy is in the jacket, obviously. That's a very classic American guitar design that he plays. There he is again with the same, well, that's probably his original one, and that's the signature custom shop one that they've made a few of to sell and to give to him. There's Dick Gocken with a massive dreadnought sometime in the 70s for like a huge sounding guitar. There's Damien O'Kane, the amazing Damien O'Kane, with a Collings dreadnought, similar guitar but different maker than the Martin one that I think Dick Gocken's got there. Again, for that big strumming sound. Then we're looking at like more British guitar design now. We'll look at some filed guitars made by Roger Bucknell and team. He started, doing these designs in the 70s. If you look at the list of people who were playing his guitars then, pretty amazing, and the list of people playing his instruments now as well. There's one of his guitars, and there's another, and you can see the difference between that kind of aesthetic, and if you listen to them, you can hear the huge difference between the sound and the aesthetic from them versus the American designs. Then we'll look at Sobel guitars, which are just phenomenal things. He's based in Hexham, Northumberland. As you can see from the second picture there, it's got like a, it's not an arch top guitar in that, you know, like this one here is a flat top guitar. That's, you know, steel string acoustic guitars are generally flat tops. That one's a kind of arch, but it's not an arch top, like an actual arch top guitar. It's just the way he makes them, and that's part of the incredible unique sound that they have. And then we're going to look at some kind of Celtic, for want of a better word, guitar designs. These are made by George Loudon and team. And you can see the way that they, you know, aesthetically the difference, and then when you listen to them tonally the difference, and voicing wise. That's made by Taran Guitars, and I think that's an Avalon guitar there. So you can see all the differences. And obviously using all these different instruments when you're accompanying traditional songs gives you loads of different tonal colours to paint with, and those are different options. Techniques and approaches we'll look at now. So say if we're accompanying a song, in fact I'll just get this in tune. So there's lots of ways and techniques and approaches you can do to accompanying, you can use to accompanying a traditional song. A quite straightforward one first, we'll look at just chords. So say if we take a song, take the banks of Sweet Primroses. So, that's just straight chords going through it. Works very well. It's all nice. Or we can add some harmonies as well. So it'd be. Quite hard to put those harmonies actually in just off the cuff like that. But I think you get my point. Just little ways you can fill out that space and give yourself a nice cushion to sit on whilst you're singing, you know, so that your voice can sit on that cushion, as it were. So you can follow the melody quite strictly if you want in a. By just. Playing the melody and singing along with it is also a great approach. Or you can go against it, then like with the harmony earlier, which is quite difficult to do off the cuff, and it would be. So. You're doing like counter melodies against it, which aren't the same as the melody that you're singing. That generally needs a bit of practice beforehand, though, so you know exactly what you're going to do on it. And that's a very Nick Jones thing to do, playing a different melody to the one that you're singing at the same time. Chordal clashes, which you can use, which can be actually be really tasty. So that's using chords underneath the melody whilst you're singing it, that don't necessarily fit with the tune. So earlier, at the top, when I was doing chords with it, which is. They all fit, you know, quite mathematically with the melody. You can use chords which don't necessarily fit mathematically in the traditional sense of the word Western classical music wise against those things to create some quite interesting sounds. So we'll use a four first. So that's chord 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So four is here. So it'd be. That was using it a little bit more than you might do, but to prove the point, it can add a kind of a discord in there, but not necessarily a nasty one. It's just you want to resolve that tension and go back to. I think your brain kind of wants it to go back to one again. So it can be a useful thing to use. Same for five. So four, five. And your brain's going like, ooh, go back to. Go back to one again. Or six, which is the relative, six being relative, it's the relative minor of one. I can't go too much into that now, because I only understand it in my own strange roundabout way. But if you want to look up more of that, I'm sure there's proper music theory lessons online for that. But so that would be something like the six would be. So it's quite a nice unsettling sound, but not unsettling in a bad way. So you can use all of those ways to bring out the best in your accompaniment. More approaches. The fingernail flick. Nick Jones kind of developed this originally British folk guitar wise, as far as I know, but I could be very much wrong on that subject with that point. But it comes from banjo frailing, and yeah, Martin Simpson also hugely the master of this. Where you. Flicking the string. Like that. And it creates a really good percussive sound, which is really good for emphasising and bringing out like certain notes that you're playing within the melody or in the chord. And then the last of these approaches we'll quickly look at. Obviously, I haven't had, there's not too, I mean, we could spend actual hours and hours and hours and hours and hours and days just looking at all these things, but we don't have the time just today, obviously, because we can't just stay up for 48 hours straight just looking at guitars as much as we want to. So apologies for the quick run through all these things, but harp guitar, which is where you're trying to leave as many strings ringing on the instrument at once as you can. So and you can bring the melody out using that, and it creates quite a full sound. So example would be, so yeah, have a banana on one string, fine, yeah, have a banana, works fine. Or you can put it across a couple of strings though, they're all hanging and ringing like they're a harp. It's just a useful thing. Obviously, that's not the best example in the world, have a banana, but I think it puts across the point. So yeah, very Martin Carthy and Martin Simpson-esque is that. Paints big pictures. And then next up, we're going to move on now, and we're going to look at some examples and people who do this type of thing and those things that we've been talking about and the sound of their guitars and the sound of their techniques. Let's have a look at some specific songs. So, versions of these traditional songs with guitar accompaniment techniques. So, yeah, we'll go into the first up. We'll look at Martin Carthy and his version of The Bedmaking from the brilliant album Crown of Horn. It's got loads of like flicks and kicks and some great chord stuff going in with it, within it. And there's a super heavy, it's a, like the one beat, the one, one, one. One, like just driving like a kind of kick drum. It's very Martin Carthy, that great to listen out for. I've written here, it's as groovy gets. It really is. It's just like a big slice of rock and roll, basically, this. It's just so rhythmic, what he's playing, and it's so perfect and treats the song so well. And then, because it's so British folk guitar, there's kind of like Morris slows in the middle of the song. So we'll have a little listen to that now.
My father, he was a good old man. He put me to service when I was very young. Me missus and me, we never could agree, because that me master, he would love me. Missus sent me upstairs to the loft to make up a bed so neat and soft. Master followed after with the gay gold ring, saying, "Betty, have this for your bed making." All through the kitchen and down through the hall, all through the parlour among the women all, master followed after with the gay gold ring, saying, "Betty, have this for your bed making." Missus come upstairs in a great haste, caught the master there with his arm round me waist. From the top to the bottom stairs she did him fling, saying, "Mr. Rab, that for your bed making." All through the kitchen and down through the hall, all through the parlour among the women all, everybody asked me wherever I had been, and they laughed and I said, "The bed making."
Wicked. Yeah, you can really hear that. All those techniques that he's using there, like what we were talking about a minute ago, and you can hear the sound of his Martin guitar a lot in that one. And next up, we're going to go back to Nick Jones, and we're going to listen to a song from this incredible album. Like with Crown of Horn, and like with this album, if you like what you're hearing and you don't already own any of these, then go and buy yourself a copy and support these amazing human beings who have put so much wonderfulness into the world. This one, yes, is Lakes of Shiloh off of Game Set Match, which is an amazing live compilation album of Nick Jones. Listen out for the flicks in this one, those banjo-y type frailing flicks. There's loads of great ones all over the shop. Loads of brilliant harmony lines that he's playing going against the melody that he's singing. He also does a lot in this one of this kind of right-hand string pull for what I've written is intense right-hand string pull for maximum snapback effect, where he's kind of pulling the string up, if you can see there, and then it snaps back down, just to make a really rhythmic, hard-hitting, voluminous sound. So have a listen to this.
Well, it's early one morning, Billy Henry arose and straight to his comrade's bedchamber he goes, saying, "Rise, loving comrade, let nobody know." To the dark and chilly waters a bathing he'll go. Billy instantly stripped, and then he went in, and he swam the dark waters all round and around, saying, "Oh, me loving comrade, oh, don't you go in, for I see there is a coffin in the lakes of Shiloh." But the other one he stripped, and then he went in, and he swam the dark waters all round and around, saying, "Oh, me Billy Henry, why did you go in to the dark and chilly waters in the lakes of Shiloh?"
Now we'll listen to, well, actually we'll watch as well. We'll have a little look at the amazing Seamy O'Dowd, who's an incredible guitarist and singer from Sligo. He used to play with Dervish. He's been in loads of bands, The Unwanted, lots of other things, lots of amazing solo stuff, and he does a lot of rock stuff as well. And this particular one, The Dark-Eyed Sailor, that he's going to do in this video, is a great example of the hybrid type plectrum and your fingers style. He uses loads of really nice chords in it, and lots of that, remember that six chord we were playing around with earlier? So there's one, and that's six chord. There's lots of that six, which brings out the melancholy, plaintive feel of the song, at least to my mind it does anyway. So we'll listen to that now.
Thanks very much. There's a little song called The Dark-Eyed Sailor. Here you go. As I went to walking one evening fair, it being the summer to take the air, I spied a fair maid and a sailor boy, and I stood to listen, and I stood to listen, to hear what they might say. Well, he said, young maid, why do you roam? The day been long and the night been cold. Well, she heaved a sigh and the tears did fall. For my dark-eyed sailor, for my dark-eyed sailor, who ploughs the stormy seas. Well, before my William went off to sea, one half of a ring he did leave with me, and one half of the ring, it's still here with me. And the other's rolling, and the other's rolling at the bottom of the sea. When he said, young maid, why do you cry? For another fair sailor you surely would find. For love turns aside, and it soon grows cold, like a winter's morning, like a winter's morning, the hills are white with snow. Well, she said, I'll not forsake my dear, although we're parting for many's the year. For genteel was he, not a rake like you, to induce the maiden, to induce the maiden, to slide the jacket blue. Well, one half of the ring did young William show, and she ran the track down with grief and woe, saying, William, William, I have gold in store for my dark-eyed sailor, for my dark-eyed sailor, for he has come home again. Well, there is a cottage by yonder lane, the couple live there and do agree. So maids, be true when your love's at sea, for a stormy morning, for a stormy morning brings on a sunny day.
He's just a monster, isn't he? That's like, he's properly phenomenal. That's amazing. And so next up, we are going to move on to another monster. Again, I'm using that in the best sense of the word. A monster, like a good monster. Monster, you know, monstrously talented, shall we say. This is the amazing Martin Simpson. This is the song Creeping Jane, his version of that. Amazing flicks and kind of harmony lines all over the place, and really nice little triad chordal harmonies going around. What I quite like about this one is it's quite a staccato part, so staccato is like kind of quick, short, little notes, to put that quite simply, and that contrasts really nicely to the quite smooth, legato-y, wavy piano accordion sound on this one. So we'll have a listen to this now.
Very pretty one concerning Creeping Jane. Oh, for she never saw a man or gelding in her life that she valued at the worth of half a pin. All the day, the diddle, all the died. Oh, for she never saw a man or gelding in her life that she valued at the worth of half a pin. All the day. And when Creeping Jane to the racecourse came, gentlemen, they giggled all around. Oh, and all they had to say concerning little Jane, she's not able for to gallop o'er the ground all the day, the diddle all the tide. Oh, and all they had to say concerning little Jane, she's not able for to gallop o'er the ground all the day. And when they came to the first mile post, Creeping Jane, he was so far behind. Oh, but the laddie flung his whip around her bonny little neck, and he said, me little lassie, never mind all the day, the diddle all the died. Oh, and the laddie flung his whip around her bonny little neck, and he said, me little lassie, never mind all the day. And when they came to the third mile post, Creeping Jane, he was so blithe and smart. Oh, and then she lifted up.
And now we'll have some more Martin Simpson, but here he's accompanying the brilliant Faye Heald on her version of The Cuckoo. This one is a really good example of where the guitar part is following the voice. So he's like behind the voice, he's following what she's singing. It's not a set contained part where the guitar is, you know, holding the foundation and the voice is sitting on top of it. It's a very fluid, they're both moving within and out each other in that kind of way, with lots of room for movement, which is really interesting and a nice approach that lets the song breathe. And then that moves into it becoming a more beat-led, heavier part where the voice can sit on top of it. It's nice to see how it moves into that, to kind of that realm. There's nice flicks everywhere. There's bottom string flicks. It's flicking the bottom strings, which is a bit unusual, but makes a really cool effect. And then we're going to listen to the whole of this track, because then at the end, there is a banjo part, which he's playing as well, which Martin Simpson's playing as well, and with lots of frailing, and that's quite interesting, frailing like flicking stuff, and that's quite interesting how that relates to the guitar part, you know, earlier on in the song, and what we've been saying about that being a technique you can use. So, yeah, I'm looking forward to listening to all of this one.
pretty bird. She sings as she flies. She brings us glad tidings and tells us no lies. She sucks on the wild bird's eggs to keep her voice clear. The summer draws near. As I was awoken by the side of a bush, I heard two birds whistling, the blackbird
thank you.
Great. Well, we're on our last example now. This is our last one to look at. And yes, this also gives me another opportunity to say that all of the music that you've been enjoying, you know, do go and check it out, investigate more, buy CDs from some of these wonderful artists, help support them in this time. This next band, which we're going to look at, and the next guitarist, is a band called The Flighting. And the song is called Caroline of Edinburgh Town. And the guitarist here is a wonderful guitarist called Alistair Paul, who's Scottish and is currently based in Newcastle. And in this one, in fact, it's a video again, so we're going to get to watch them. And you'll be able to see his filed guitar. I think it's a filed Orsino. You'll be able to hear like the kind of unique tone of that guitar. Also, he's playing with a pick through all of it, and I'm quite sure he's in standard tuning. So listen out for the way he's using that to help support the song and the singer. This is, yeah, The Flighting.
Come on, you pretty fair maids, and listen to my rhyme. It's of a pretty fair young maid, being scarcely in her prime. She beats the blooming roses, she's admired by all around. Some call her blooming Caroline of Edinburgh Town. Young Henry being a Highland lad, a-courting to her came. And when her parents came to know, they got angry at the same. Young Henry being offended, these words to her did say: "Arise up, blooming Caroline, and with me come away." And we'll go down to London town, to London with great speed. We will go down to London town, get married there indeed. She bundled up her costly robes as the tears came tumbling down.
Thank you.
upon the ground. Some people they do pity her, whilst others do on her frown. And others say, what made you stray from Edinburgh town? Twas down by an oak that this maid sat down to cry, that she might see the English fleet as they go passing by. She gave me signs for Henry as she plunged her body down. And away went blooming Caroline of Edinburgh town.
Right then, as this slide now says, righty-ho, that's it then. We're coming now to the end of the workshop slash presentation, The History of the British Folk Guitar. Thank you very much for watching. I hope you've had a nice time, wherever you are and whatever you're up to and wherever you sat or stood. Do head on over to the Sidmouth Folk Festival crowdfunder page, where there's still loads of brilliant rewards left, and help care for the best week of the year every year, apart from the week before Christmas. But I mean, that's a pretty good second place, isn't it? Yeah, that's just my opinion on it anyway. And yeah, go get yourself some rewards and help care for Sidmouth. That's a good thing to do. And oh, this is what I was going to say to you. Homework. You don't feel obliged, but if you fancy some homework, as you are watching the Sidmouth Folk Festival online concerts coming up, then you can look out for guitar things within the concerts and how people are playing them, and you can, you know, work out, oh, are they playing with a pick, are they playing with their fingers, or are they a hybrid player? And you can say, oh, I wonder if they're using an open tuning or not. See if you can notice that type of thing. If you don't want to, then you don't have to. You might be old enough so that you don't have to do homework anymore and you grew out of that a long time ago. But if you fancy it, then do that. That could be quite fun. And also, one second. Yes, support the great musicians in this presentation, buying their CDs. Yeah, supporting them online concerts, etc. But yes, I will see you at Sidmouth in 2021, if not before. Looking forward to it. You can do your homework then, there too, as well. You can, in fact, your homework can be ongoing for the rest of your life, if you want to keep learning more about it. But like I say, thank you very much for having me in your front room or garden or wherever you are. Have a nice rest of your day. See you around and about. Thank you very much.